Assalamu alaikum, friends. I welcome you all for Engineers Day celebration by humble intellectuals. We have all assembled to celebrate Engineers Day, that is the birthday of Bharat Ratna Sir M. Visveshwaraya. I welcome the distinguished speakers and the respected participants for this celebration. The first speaker amongst us is Engineer Ali Ehtisham, an officer of Indian Telecom Services. He is currently working as Senior General Manager, Bharat Broadband Network Limited, Darbhanga, Jharkhand. He will be speaking on the topic Internet in India, National Optical Fiber Network and Cyber Security Challenges. I have also the honor of reading his distinguished profile. Mr. Ali Ehtisham is a Bachelor of Electronics Engineering from Aligarh Muslim University. After completion of engineering degree, he worked as a lecturer for 2 years in the Department of Electronics and Communications Engineering, Jamia Millia Islamia, New Delhi. He has also worked as a design engineer in Semiconductor Complex Limited, Mohali, Chandigarh, for a year. He joined Indian Telecommunications Service, ITS, in the year 1999 through the engineering services examination conducted by Union Public Service Commission, Government of India. He has served as a senior officer in BSNL Bangalore, Mysore, Kolkata and Ranchi. At present, he is on deputation to Bharat Broadband Network Limited, that is BBNL, and posted as Senior General Manager at Dhanbad, Jharkhand. He is currently looking after the work of BharatNet in the state of Jharkhand. I welcome Mr. Ali Ehtisham for this meeting. I hope we will all be benefited with his speech. Welcome you, sir.
This distinguished guest from Mysore area, for these two reasons, this Engineers Day celebrated for, as you know, for the legendary engineer Bharat Ratna, Sri M. Visveshwaraya. And then, just a few days back, India has become the fourth country in the world after US, China and Russia to develop and successfully test a hypersonic missile technology that will pave the way for missiles traveling at 6 times the speed of sound. And what is the, I mean to say, it's a matter of great joy, because the whatever the feather in the cap of India, that the genesis of the telephone is one of the few inventions which right after its invention, it has become so much inalienable part of our life. So we can see what we can say, now it is the age of online learning and distance education. So this slide may be termed the first online lecture. It is being given by Alexander Graham Bell, who actually invented the telephone in 1876. You see, upper slide, he is giving lecture in Massachusetts, and his friends are listening to his lecture on a telephone at in Boston. So this we may say that it is the first online lecture of the world. And this, the inventor of the telephone, he is inaugurating a telephone line from New York to Chicago in 1892. So this may qualify as the first STD telephone line of the world. And these are, whenever any new invention comes, so there will always be some positive reactions as well as negative reactions, mainly due to the ignorance. So we'll see what some of the famous quotes regarding the telephone. The day, the Alexander Graham Bell himself says, the day will come when the man at the telephone will be able to see the distant person to whom he is speaking. That means he was able to visualize the capability of video call, which is so common today. And just see the third quote, transmission of documents via telephone wires is possible in principle, but the apparatus required is so expensive that it will never become a practical proposition. Do you know who this scientist? That means at that time, even people were not very, very apprehensive that like fax transmission or some photo or some PDF file, what we are sending through telephone. In fact, Dennis Geber himself is a big physicist, and he in fact got a Nobel Prize for a discovery of the hologram. He was also apprehensive. A scientist was also apprehensive. Regarding the whether telephone will have that capability, and we'll just see the fourth quotation, which is very much, you can say, prophetic in nature. I have always, she is a very famous American author, I have always been allergic to telephones. As far as I am concerned, there are very seldom time savers and very often the destroyers of schedule. This what we are seeing today. We are so much lost in the telephones that we don't have any, we are missing so many things.
You know, Hafiz kon malum hai.
And this slide is very important. In fact, persons who are already interested in history, they may be knowing. It is thanks to the telephone we have been spared the specter of another world war. What we say that a hotline telephone is nothing but the moment you lift the receiver, the call starts ringing at a predetermined number. But that term, that hotline was a special telephone. It was a direct phone line between Washington and Moscow to facilitate instant communication between the US president and the Soviet leader. In fact, in Cuban missile crisis, and so many, had there not been any telephone, even a small misunderstanding or accident would have resulted in an all-out nuclear war. So we owe a lot, this world peace, we owe a lot to the telephone, actually. And just a slight, the history at our Indian telephone. Previously, there were no telephones. In fact, it was started in the form of a telegraph only. And the telegraphic signal, for the first time, the telegraphic signal was sent between Calcutta and Diamond Harbor in 1850. An Indian Telegraph Act, actually that act, which is governing the various rules regarding telecommunication in India, even today, with some amendments, it's more than 100 years old. It is, in fact, 1885. And internet, which is so commonplace now, it was launched 25 years back by VSNL, that is Videsh Sanchar Nigam Limited, in 1995, 15th August. And mobile phone services started in 1996. And then we'll see something which is, we have to see, that is cyber security. Anything connected to internet is called cyber. Anything connected to internet is called cyber. So if somebody is doing fraud on the internet, it is cyber fraud. If somebody is securing the internet, it is called cyber security. If somebody is threat, there are certain threat actors who are actually sending virus, worms, they are called cyber threats. So basically there are three things. One is cyber environment, cyber threats, and then cyber security. What is cyber security? Because now we see that all the networks are connected. Suppose this is my mobile phone. If I switch on the data connection, So it is connected to the internet world. It becomes a part of millions and billions of such systems which are connected all over the world. And the moment I am getting connected to internet, I am becoming a cyber environment. So what is the reason why there are so much threats? Because ubiquitous access. You can access the internet from anywhere. And so many systems and networks are connected. And cybersecurity is definitely a highly undesirable thing because it leads to like denial of service attacks. Suppose then theft of financial and personal data, network failures, disruption of voice and data. And what is cyber environment? Suppose I am having a mobile phone or I am having an IP phone. This is also a cyber environment. With VoIP, a desk telephone is part of the cyber environment. This is cyber threats and vulnerabilities. Any threat or vulnerability to the cyber environment is called cyber threat. Viruses, worms, frozen horses, identity theft, spams, cyber attacks. Cyber security threats are growing rapidly, both in the form of in its frequency, that means they are becoming more frequent, as well as in severity, that means in the quantum of damage which it can do to our systems. And to fight any threat or vulnerability, the first and foremost thing is we have to have a clear picture, clear understanding what a cyber threat is. And like you can see, a cyber environment includes users like you and me. So many, like 20 to 25 persons are now attending the Zoom session. So these 22, the mobile phones or laptops or iPads of these 25 guests are also have become a cyber environment for the time they are connected to the network. So any device, whether it is your phone, whether it is any software, whether it is any memory, anything, it is called a cyber environment. And any threat to the cyber environment is called cyber threat. And this is how, that means cyber security, you can say in itself a C. It is a very wide term. And the cyber techniques. So, cutting short my discussion of cyber security, there are, because every government, there are stakes are so high for the usage of internet and broadband that it is the every government takes certain initiatives to protect its citizens from cyber crimes, cyber frauds. So these are some of the cyber security initiatives being taken by the government of India. A nodal agency under Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology, that is Indian Computer Emergency Response Team,
sir. There is a disturbance. One second, Hitesham sir. Somebody's mic is on. It is disturbing. Tehsin sir, aapka mobile mic on hai. Please, would you please off it?
Shall I continue? I
am muting all and then unmute you. Okay. Please unmute after some time. I am muting all now because of disturbance. Ehtasham sahab, you please unmute and come online. Hello? Ali Ehtasham sahab?
I am unmuted, sir. Huh?
Yeah, please come online.
Am I audible?
Yeah, please.
So it is the duty of every government to protect its citizens, because now you can say cyber attacks are like, suppose some in the olden days some army is attacking you, so that is causing certain fatalities, certain you can say undesirable consequences. So now attacks have become more sophisticated. So likewise, it is the duty of every government to protect its citizens, the assets of its citizens, as well as vital installations from cyber threats being perpetrated by certain named and unnamed threat actors. So in India, under the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology, we have a nodal agency that is called Indian Computer Emergency Response Team, CERT-IN. What is the CERT-IN doing? It is preventing cyber attacks. It is responding to cyber attacks and one is thing, you are responding to cyber attack. Then if some cyber attacks takes place, then that extent of damage has to be minimized and the recovery of the system has to be fast. That means the downtime of the affected system should be as minimum as possible. And as well as cyber security awareness among common citizens, because all common citizens of the country cannot be electronics or computer engineer. They don't know much about the cyber security and all those things. So it is the duty of that, one of the functions of CERT-IN is to educate and make aware the common citizens, layman citizens of the country, in user-friendly, in understandable terms, what is cyber threat, what are the simple steps you have to take to protect your systems and all that. And periodically, it will issue forecasts and alerts of cyber threats, which we'll be shortly seeing some examples in the context of India. And it issues guidelines, advisories. Sometimes it will issue advice. We'll see one or two examples, and you can very well go to this website. It's a very informative website. You can go actually learn a lot of things there. So whatever some advisories which this nodal agency issues, we'll be appreciating it. Like suppose now, because every pandemic, it is not to be missed, but see, the threat actors are using the pandemic also to perpetrate cyber crimes. So the Honorable Prime Minister has constituted a PM CARES Fund, and immediately the mind of those cyber threat actors clicked, and see, they have made so many websites imitating as if these are the UPI addresses of the PM CARES Fund. And any gullible citizen, due to sympathy and empathy for the epidemic, they will click on any of these and start donating the money. But these money will not go to the PM CARES Fund, but it will actually go to some unscrupulous coffers. The genuine UPID is PM CARES. So you just see how they are. Here, between this ID and this ID, the difference is only this S. So we have to be very careful. Any address, any URL, we have to study, examine each and every word. This red color is the fake ID, and this blue color is the genuine ID. The difference between red and blue is only this small S, which any person is likely to miss. And he may click here to contribute in the fund, but actually it will go into some antisocial elements account. So this is one example. And this is another example. What is phishing? Phishing is nothing but these threat emails. Whatever misleading information you are getting through mails, those types of emails are called phishing emails. So what these cyber actors are doing, phishing campaigns impersonating popular. Suppose some email will come to you, like say, update your Zoom. Have some extra features in your Zoom. And the moment you click it, some malware will automatically download in your PC and it will start stealing the information. Or they will entice you that who is the World Health Organization. They will say that who has issued the latest advisory click here to see the latest advisory against COVID from you. And the moment actually it is not from you, it is from some state actor. And like Arogya Setu, for example, Arogya Setu, they will say, please click on the link to see the number of patients in your neighborhood. Like these, some very catchy type of.
Yeah, Abdul Hafiz, one to me. How are you?
So they will, these types of things they through SMS, any unethical SMS aimed at emanating from a cyber threat actor is called SMSing. Any negative type or any unscrupulous message sent through a WhatsApp is called vishing, and of course through emails it is called phishing. So they are nothing but they will steal your identities, and they will steal your they may download some malware in your PC or tablet or smartphone, and that malware itself will start sending so many information. Maybe you are doing some payment from your smartphone, so all your user ID, password, that may be transmitted to the person who is actually monitoring your phone through that malware. So these are some of the best practices. In most of the cyber attacks, either phishing or spear phishing. What is the difference between phishing and spear phishing? Like we are, phishing means it is a general email which is broadcast to everybody. But spear phishing means it is a very intelligent type of email. They will somehow gather that. Suppose you are accessing. Suppose spear email. It will the moment you see that email in your box, it will be targeted. Like it will be in your name only, or it might be coming from somebody whom you know. So that is very intelligent type of email that is called spear phishing. To deliver malware. Malware is nothing but a small, you can say, virus or software which will automatically download in your computer the moment you click on that link, and it will sit in your computer and do all those cyber crime things. So how to check these things? We need to understand the tactics of the cyber threat actors and urgently secure the internet connected systems. Any system which is not at all connected to internet. So we need not bother until unless we put some, now floppies mostly are not coming. So like servers, tablets, etc. Both at the organization, that means our office PCs are there, office servers are there, as well as user level, our personal laptops are there, tablets are there, etc. And these are some of the cyber practices. In limited time, it's not possible to go through everything. But you can just see, like, do not open attachments in unsolicited emails. Even if they come from people you know in the contact list, never click on a URL contained in an unsolicited email, even if the link seems genuine. And exercise caution when opening email attachments, even if the attachment is expected and the sender appears to be known. That means whatever email is coming to you, you have to see it with a suspicious eyes. And then scan for and remove suspicious email attachments. So, block the attachments of file types. These are certain file types which you should never click and open, like exe file, command file, and so many things. And beware about phishing domain spelling errors in emails. Like we have seen, it is PM care and PM cares. So that spelling error we have to see. Websites and unfamiliar email senders. And we have to check the integrity of URLs before providing logging credentials or. And then be cautious of tiny URLs. Sometimes we'll see in our SMS some message is coming that you have won this award. Please click on the link to reclaim your award, etc. So we have to be cautious on those tiny URLs. And then do not submit personal information to unknown and unfamiliar websites. Beware of clicking on phishing URLs. We have to use spam filters. And be wary of storing personal information on various social media and other public platforms. Do not share financial details, e-wallet details or banking details with anyone. And this is very important. Regularly check the last login details of your accounts. And always use genuine software. Install the latest updates, patches for OS, antivirus and software. And now we'll shortly see in 10-15 minutes what is the broadband services. So this is the definition of the broadband service as per the Government of India. And always on service where the minimum download speed is 512 kbps. From the point of presence of the service provider, suppose you are accessing a site whose server is lying in USA. So that speed cannot be guaranteed to 512. Suppose you are accessing this internet on a 3G phone or a 4G phone. So a broadband connection will guarantee you a 512 kbps only from your smartphone to the nearest BTS. And if you are using a wireline telephone, only to the telephone exchange and not beyond. That is how it is being defined. And why there is so much hue and cry about the broadband? Because it is a great enabler of economic development. According to a study by the World Bank, if 10% increase is there in broadband penetration, it leads to a boost of 1.38% in GDP. So it is directly, in fact, researchers have shown that so of all the activities, the broadband penetration is the a single activity which is having the most pronounced positive effect on the GDP growth. And these are some of the benefits of broadband, which we already know, so no need of repeating. So this also we know why it is there. It is promoting transparency, financial inclusion, helping in agrarian sector, agriculture, and it is enabling the emergence of small and medium enterprises. So all those things we already know. So this is, we can see, sir, the broadband growth in India. In December, at the end of December 2016, we were having a little under 24 crore broadband customers, which in a span of 3 years, that is at the end of December 2019, it is almost a little above 66 crores. So 66 crores also, you can say it is not a very good or it is not a matter of celebration, because 66 crores divided by 130 crores, that means still it is very less. Tele density is very less. That means it is nearly 50% only. That means only one out of two people are exposed to the broadband. And any broadband speed which is less than 512, it is called narrow band, and above 512, it is called broadband. So see that same graph, what we have seen here, the same graph is there in another fashion. Here also we see that it is a continuous jump. And you see, and this is and at the end of March 2020, it is a very latest figure. How many total internet customers are there? It is 74 crores. 74 crores means around 55% of the population. And this 55% of the population is on an Indian scale. That doesn't mean 55% penetration in urban area and 55% penetration in rural area. It may be 80% urban and maybe 20% rural only. And this is the exact, see how you see, same thing is there. Urban internet subscribers per 100 is, it is more than 106, see how, it is more than one. That means in, and rural internet subscribers per 100, it is only 29, very less. And now we'll see some of graphs. Because India is the largest democracy in the world, it is one of the largest countries. Its GDP is also among the, it is a G20, it is one of the countries in the G20 list. So we will just see how do we compare among the countries of the world. You see, and this is the global average broadband speed measured from July 2019 to July 2020. Broadband are two types. One is your mobile broadband, that is 3G and 4G, and then your landline broadband, that is fixed broadband. So here in mobile broadband, the average speed, download speed is 34.5 Mbps. And in fixed broadband, it is 81.46 Mbps. That means it's more than double. So you take it, it is a thumb rule that the quality, speed, all the properties of a broadband will always be better in a landline broadband compared to a mobile broadband. Landline broadband will always be better in terms of speed, in terms of quality, in terms of, you can say, its stability compared to your 3G or 4G mobile broadband. And then India is a member of a BRICS country, that is BRICS, the other organization, Brazil, India, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. Here also, we cut a very sorry figure. See, in Brazil also, this is the mobile speed. You see, in all the countries, mobile broadband speed is much less than the landline broadband speed. And here also, we score the least in terms of broadband speed among the BRICS countries, whether it is a landline broadband or a mobile broadband. And here we are also cutting a very sorry picture. You see, this is a very latest data of July 2020. And here you can see the mobile broadband, top three countries of the world in July 2020, UAE, the download speed is 110 Mbps. See, fantastic speed. Second is South Korea. Third is China, 105. And India cuts a sorry figure at 127, 12 Mbps speed. It is poorer, in fact, than its neighbors like Sri Lanka, Pakistan, and Nepal. And here in fixed line, it's slightly better than the SAARC countries, but on a world scale also, India stands nowhere. That is 75th position in the broadband speed of landline telephones. So we have seen that the broadband holds so much promise for the India. It is having so much potential to catapult India from the tag of a developing country to a developed country. But what are the limitations? What is lagging in our broadband revolution? The first is, of course, the speed. The speed is very less. And this is the second lagging point. Poor connectivity. That means where... poor connectivity. This is basically true for rural areas. First of all, connectivity to the majority of the population is not there. That is one negative point. Second shortcoming is that wherever connectivity is there, it is not up to the mark. That means its speed is slow. It is not very much reliable. So to attend to all these problems, the government has formed a national broadband mission, where all these problems will be addressed. These are some of the salient points of this National Broadband Mission or Rashtriya Broadband Abhiyan. You just see the last point, ensure connectivity to all uncovered areas. So it is a very ambitious plan that by 2022, each and every household in India means India is having 6.64 lakh villages total. So that means all 6.64 lakh villages in every household of village, because of course urban area will always be there. Our urban area, we have always seen this broadband is already up to the at least the penetration of broadband is quite high. So in rural area, each household will have broadband connection by 2022. Very ambitious plan. And how this ambitious plan will be actually taken forward, for this the government of India has formed a special purpose vehicle that is called Bharat Broadband Network Limited. That is a government of India undertaking, which is actually laying the national optical fiber network. What is this? The technical name of this project is NOFAN, National Optical Fiber Network. And it's the government has rechristened it as BharatNet to be more reflective of what it is actually. So what is the project doing? Project is taking the high speed connectivity and optical fiber. Please keep in mind that the speed of internet will always be guaranteed. All the qualities will be there only if the internet is through an optical fiber and not through any mobile or radio link or Wi-Fi. So what this ambitious BharatNet or NOFAN project will do, it will take the optical fiber to all the 2.5 lakh gram panchayats. So total there are around 6.6 lakh villages or grams and 2.5 lakh gram panchayats. That means under the jurisdiction of one gram panchayat, there may be 5 to 6 grams or villages. So it is the world's largest rural broadband connectivity project. So what it is doing? It is taking the optical fiber only up to the gram panchayat. And then beyond gram panchayat, how it will go? It will go through a mix of maybe optical fiber, or it can go also through Wi-Fi, etc. This is what is to be seen. As last mile connectivity means from the gram panchayat downwards towards the villages. It is using Wi-Fi technology or any other suitable broadband technology. How the net will be taken down below. And these are some of the promises which all I'll show you that how we are already into it. Like all those e-governance services, what we have to come to a government office. Now it is going to the doorstep, or you can say to a village, so that people can access there only, like all those e-governance services. In fact, it is a very ambitious project. And when the project will fully fructify, these are some of the services which will be available at the doorstep of each and every citizen. E-governance services, what, like land records, birth, death certificates, Aadhaar-based services, NAREGA, e-healthcare, like telemedicine, e-education. A glimpse of e-education we are already seeing in this COVID, when Zoom-based online classes are there even for the kids. Then public internet access, that means a villager or can go to the nearest internet cyber cafe, which is already there in his village only, and he need not come to the nearest town or urban area for the same. And then e-commerce, employment generation, and so many things. So out of this is the progress of this project as of now. Out of 2.5 lakh gram panchayats, more than 1.5 lakh gram panchayats have already been connected with optical fiber, and services are already working in 1.15 lakh gram panchayats broadband connections. 1.15 lakh broadband connections are already available. And in this 15th August address from the Red Fort, Honorable Prime Minister has again laid a very ambitious project. This is 1.5 lakh gram panchayats already connected with high speed broadband fiber. So optical fiber in remaining 1 lakh, because 2.5 minus 1.5, roughly 1 lakh. So 1 lakh GPs, it is to be completed by this year end, that is 2020. And within the next 1,000 days, that means this is 23, that means by 15th August 23, all 6.5 lakh villages in India should have some form of broadband connection. So so any villager, anywhere in India, whether he is in Lakshadweep, whether he is in Andaman, whether he is in Saranda mines area of Jharkhand, some Naxalite area, he need not move even, let's say, he need not move even 1 kilometer to access the broadband, because broadband will be available in his own village. Or maybe in through Wi-Fi on his own phone. And I just want to concentrate on this e-governance services. In fact, this is not a theoretical idea. This has already been put into practice. I'll just show you, sir, how it is being put into practice. There is something called common service center, customer service center. In fact, we already know in big cities there are certain this government or some municipalities taking, and in a single point you can go and you can pay all the utility bills and all those things. So this is the common service center, CS. It is also being promoted by the government of India only through Ministry of Electronics and IT. And what are CSCs? CSCs are the access points for delivery of various electronic services to citizens across rural India. Rural India, because urban area already people are having those services. Multiple services like Aadhaar updation, generation of land record, birth certificate, death certificate, some mark sheet, or maybe your khata generation, multiple services, single point model. And one CSC is envisaged in each of 2.5 lakh gram panchayats. So even if this fructifies, that means 5 to 6 villages will have at least one CSC. So the maximum distance which they need to travel to access, let's say their any Aadhaar record or birth certificate, hardly 3-4 kilometers, that's all. And as of now, 1 lakh CSCs are already functioning in various capacities. And these are some of the services which already this utility. In fact, they are also acting as micro credit and loans. In fact, I chanced to visit one of the CSC in a remote area in Ranchi, Jharkhand. There I could see a very fantastic CSC person was maintaining a very fantastic office. It was there. Printer, scanner, your phone, this video. This video web camera, everything was there. In fact, he was also acting as a bank. So maybe to a ceiling of 10,000 rupees or 15,000 rupees, people were using his services to take the money as well as deposit the money there only. And it is working. And this CSC operator is the village level entrepreneur. So this CSC is doing two things. First, it is creating it is creating facilities for the rural people, as well as it is generating employment, because somebody has to maintain the CSC. So suppose 2.5 lakh CSCs are there. So immediately 2.5 lakh persons and one helper, maybe 5 lakh employment will be generated. So 5 lakh families will immediately get some sort of livelihood. And these are some of the challenges being faced in BharatNet, because it is authority. What are the various challenges? This the equipment from fiber, something called optical network terminal. It is to be placed, installed somewhere in some safe building in a village. Only from there internet lines will be taken out. So these are normally installed in village panchayats. And if village panchayat buildings are not available in some Anganwadi Kendras, community centers, etc. But sometimes I have a personal experience in so many villages are so backward that not a single government building is there. And some of the villages are also where even if some buildings are there, the roof will be leaking, very dilapidated, and there will be no doors and windows. Then who will take the security? Who will ensure the security and safety of the equipment? And then these are given the precarious condition of electricity. All these ONT sets are designed to operate only with solar panel. So that is becoming another headache. Because so many places we have come across the theft of solar panel and battery. Villagers are simply stealing these solar panels and installing in their homes. So these are some of the bottlenecks are there, but this government is trying to overcome all those things and provide the BharatNet services to the citizens. And these are, I'll say this, some sustainable development goals. These are totally 17 sustainable development goals. These are certain goals. If it is achieved, it is said that this world will become an ideal place to live in. There will be no poor person. There will be everybody will live a life, happy life. So these 17 sustainable development goals were formulated by the United Nations in 2015, and all the member countries of UNO, they have a moral obligation to provide to its citizens these SDGs by 2030. And it has already been shown without any iota of doubt that information and communication technologies can help accelerate progress towards every single one of these 17 SDGs. So ICT will help in achieving the SDGs, and ICTs will need something. What is that something? That something is called a stable, a reliable, and fast broadband. So sustainable development goals has to be reached by 2030. And these the most critical factor in realizing those goals is our information and communication technology. And for information and communication technology, we need an internet, not any internet, but a fast internet, a safe internet, a reliable internet. And that type of internet is only possible with an optical fiber broadband, not with 4G or 5G or anything. You take it from me. The type of internet, the type of ideal internet is possible only with a broadband network which runs on optical fiber and not on 4G, 3G or 5G or whatever. That's why there is so much priority given to broadband networks. And BharatNet is nothing but the highway which is created for on which the broadband services will run. And then of course everything has a positive and negative point. And see, now I think I have almost come to an end of my talk, but now one thing I would just request for 2-3 minutes. We have seen a very different type now with this pandemic and all that. Now this online classes are almost becoming a normal feature, at least in the near future. And so what we have been told that these gadgets, just see what is the gadgets. Now with these online classes and Zoom classes, even my two kids, they have to spend at least 2 hours each daily on for Zoom classes. So now gadgets are whether it is a ticking time bomb. Gadgets have always been evil for the children, but in these prevailing circumstances of this pandemic where classes have to be done, we can say gadgets have become a necessary evil. So a necessary evil has to be, it cannot be eliminated as long as online classes are going on, but at least it can be reduced to a bare minimum. Otherwise, one of the most undesirable consequences, it is what is there, gaming addiction. It is already listed as a mental health condition by the World Health Organization. What is gaming disorder? To 2018 onwards, it is already classified as a disease. What is gaming disorder? Resulting from digital gaming or video gaming. What is it? A pattern of gaming behavior characterized by impaired control over gaming. A person, I am not having control over gaming itself. In fact, gaming is control. I am not having control over gaming. I don't have control for how many hours I am using my smartphone for some PUBG, etc. I don't have any control over gaming. Gaming is having control over me. Increasing priority given to gaming. That means of all the activities, khana, peena, exam, padhna, namaz, everything takes a back seat and gaming takes the priority. That gaming takes precedence over other interests and daily activities. And third, continuation or escalation of gaming despite the occurrence of negative consequences. Already negative consequences we may be seeing. Loss of sleep, dizziness, or maybe not able to concentrate in studies. Despite all those negative consequences, which I am aware, still it is that gaming addiction is either continuing or escalating. It is increasing. So what are the negative effects? Significant impairment in personal, family, social, educational, occupational, or other important areas of functioning. So this is not something theoretical. It is already practical and tested, and each of one of us are to some extent affected by this, either in person or our kids or maybe our grandchildren. So in fact, I'm telling you from my personal, now 2-3 slides are there. These are the slides from my personal experience. This is how we can control the gaming disorder in our kids. Books are an ingenious way to distract the child attention from the gadgets. But it's not that simply unko koi book de diya, some books we have given. We have to get involved in that book. We have to sit with our children and read those books. And then children are made readers on the laps of their parents. That means game books are the antithesis. Books are the greatest enemy of this gadget addiction or gaming addiction. So we have to seek the refuge of books. And for that, we have to study the books along with the children. And children are made readers on the laps of their parents. And let us develop family reading culture in our homes. Family reading cultures, then only to some extent we are able to distract our children from the gadgets. And I let me tell you, so this is how we have. And then now with this online classes, so many assignments, homeworks are also coming in the form of some PDF file through WhatsApp or through email. So we should not let our children to see those assignments or homeworks on the laptop or PC or smartphone. It's always better to spend a few bucks and take a physical printout of that assignment or homework and give him in paper form. Then only I hope some we'll be able to distract him to certain extent from the gadget addiction. So that brings to a close. Thank you for watching, sir.